For most of the pandemic, daily case counts were the most widely tracked and followed metric in the pandemic. Then came the Omicron variant. Justin Chandler covers the Hamilton-Niagara region for Ontario Hubs, and he joins us now on how the analytics have had to evolve. Welcome. So let's start with the most recent news first. In light of the government's announcement this week, what is the new policy for tracking cases in schools?
So the way it's going to work now is schools and childcare centers are going to report absences, and then when there's 30% of a group that is absent, that's going to trigger an alert to public health when they can determine whether or not a school is going to be closed or a childcare center, and that's when parents will be notified. So it's no longer going to be that someone in your child's class or daycare cohort or what have you has tested positive.
Now, for the past 2 years, every day I would wake up, I would look at the weather, and the next thing I would look at is the case counts. If my mom called me, the first thing she would say before she asked how I was doing, she would say, hey, did you see the case counts? But for your article for TVO.org, you interviewed Jeff Kwong, a public health researcher, and learned that those case counts aren't really a good indication of the amount of virus circulating anymore. Why is that?
Yeah, the consensus among public health experts and officials now seems to be that we're really undercounting and we're sort of just getting the tip of the iceberg with our testing now. And that's just because people can't get tested. So a good example is my household was isolating for 5 days last week because of someone had COVID symptoms. And none of us were able to get tested because now only certain high-risk workers are able to go do that. So a lot of people now are getting sick or getting symptoms, and they're just unable to actually know whether or not they have COVID. So that's not getting reported and adding to our provincial numbers.
Well, let's talk a little bit about that in general. Apart from schools, how does who can get a test and who can't play into tracking Omicron?
So that is important. Right now, testing is restricted to people in these higher risk settings because they're considered the ones who are most likely, I guess, to get COVID and sort of the most essential. So we can still take from those numbers hospitalization rates. And Jeff Kwong said that although they might not be terribly accurate because they're skewed by being in this proportion, we can still say like, okay, COVID positivity rates were closer to maybe 1% several weeks ago, and now they're closer to 30% it was at the time that him and I spoke. So whether that number's 30 or whether it's actually 25, you can still see that there was a big jump. So the test positivity rate is still useful to at least some degree.
Now, what's interesting is hospitals are being asked to distinguish who's admitted with COVID as well as their primary ailment or from COVID alone. What is gained from sort of knowing that difference?
So this has been sort of controversial. My understanding from listening to different experts and from talking to Dr. Kwong is that it could be useful to know how many people are getting really sick from the virus versus how many people are in hospital for something unrelated. An example that gets tossed around a lot is a car accident, but don't actually have a really severe case of COVID. But Dr. Kwong said where this becomes difficult is that if, let's say, someone has underlying conditions, you might not know if that condition is being exacerbated by COVID-19. Maybe they wouldn't have had to be in hospital if not for that, or maybe they're going to be there longer because of that, and it starts to get difficult. I've also heard sort of the counter argument that at least as far as where we are right now, so long as people are in hospital, that's what matters, and it doesn't really matter why they're there, given that capacity is so limited right now and hospitals are so overwhelmed.
What I found quite interesting in your article was, you know, the conversation about ICU beds, and we have this conversation about surgeries being postponed. Can you give us a little bit of an explanation as to how Omicron plays into, you know, beds not being available, surgeries being postponed because of that?
Well, for years and years, as a lot of people know, we've had problems with hospital capacity in Ontario. And right now, even though Omicron is apparently causing fewer hospitalizations as a rate than the Delta variant would have, it's causing so many more that more people are ending up in hospital and needing care. And so what's happening is that people are going to the hospital, they've got COVID-19, that takes up spots that perhaps other people going to hospital might be able to use. So hospitals are having to cut surgeries, they're having to postpone other activities, move things further down the line, different operations. And it just means that there's so much COVID in the hospitals right now, so many people needing care, that normal operations and the other things that we need just to keep our societies moving as normal, whatever we say when we mean normal, aren't happening.
All right. I want to talk about some of the other tools that public health officials have in their toolkit when it comes to tracking. And it's this term, break it down for me, syndromic surveillance. That sounds really high techy. What does that actually mean?
So this was new to me when Dr. Kwong said it. And the way he explained it is you're basically tracking something using a related indicator. So the example he used is let's say you could track that pharmacies in the community were selling a lot of diarrheals, anti-diarrheals. You might know that a lot of people in the community have diarrhea. And so the example he gave here is that we could use workplace absenteeism as a type of syndromic surveillance for COVID-19. You might not know that someone in a household has COVID-19, but if you know that they're not showing up to work, then you could potentially make some inferences there. And he said this could be useful probably on a larger scale. So you could say this community has a lot of absenteeism as compared to this community. And then that might lead you to think, okay, well, let's try and investigate why.
Now, with all of these sort of tools at our disposal, you know, there are predictions that sooner or later, all of us will get Omicron. So what's the value in making more precise determinations between COVID or what might just be, say, a regular winter cold or virus?
Well, there's a couple things here. I asked Dr. Kwong for his take to that question. And one of the things that he said was it's just more serious. So as long as people are ending up in hospital, dying, getting long COVID, having symptoms that last a long time as opposed to these other things, we really do need to know the impact and we need to try and be able to predict the impact. And I would also say just from the perspective of a journalist, and I'm sure lots of researchers and people would agree, it's just important to know what's happening. So in the future, we can refer back to this and say, did what we do worked? Like, was it worth it to have these restrictions? Was it worth it to take the steps that we did? And will we be ready for the next pandemic?
Justin, really appreciate it. Thank you so much for this update.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.